And so we dive into it. We take a look on what actually has been the legacy of Barack Obama and his speech today. He's spoken on a raft of issues today, of course, looking keenly at the triumph and also the disappointment of his legacy. We want to see how also that can correlate with Africa and what is he leaving also in the entry of the incoming president-elect, that is Donald Trump, as I mentioned earlier, who will be installed as the president of the United States. So we have with us Professor Noami Demba, and we can begin from that note. You've been also listening in on that particular speech that was given by President Barack Obama today. But we hark back to the 8 years that he has been in power so far. He came with a very promising note. People are very optimistic about his legacy. Of course, he was one of the historic presidents in the United States, being the first black American president to actually be in the White House. But looking at his speech this morning, and of course, I know you've been also transitioning from wherever you're coming from home to the studio as well. What would be some of the salient points that you think that Barack Obama raised today?
Barack Obama will go down in history as one of the greatest president of the United States, in the rank of Lincoln and others that have made substantive contribution, not only to America but to the world. But there is something very special about Barack Obama. It was unthinkable for somebody like Barack Obama to be president of United States, at least at this point, where we are. He became president.
Yes.
And so the image he created for every single young Americans and for the world, in that case, is that everything is possible. Is that if I make my mind and I work hard and I set a mindset to succeed, I will succeed. And that it is possible. Because the writer of the Constitution of the United States, very brilliant writing, made that possible in the writing. But for years since independence of the United States, that was not possible. And Obama brought it home and made it possible. And therefore, the hope of young men, young black men, women in America, a Hispanic recent immigrant, is that my son or my daughter can be president of this country. That's a very powerful statement. Several delivery, and that's why his rating is at 57% at this point, which is one of the highest for a president that has served two terms. He delivered health care, and which they're now called Obamacare.
Yes.
Irrespective of all the debate, it was not a perfect tool, but it's something of historical proportion. Because every single president since Lyndon Johnson and even others before that tried to deliver healthcare for America. And the closest person to come to that was Lyndon Johnson. The rest has failed, including Bill Clinton and everybody who have tried.
But also the Obamacare has received a lot of flack from the Republicans as well.
Well, the point is some people are trying to erase that legacy, okay? But it's the most powerful legacy that Edward Kennedy fought all his life for this thing. And if you can remember, it was Edward Kennedy who came at the very first time and supported Obama presidency.
Yes.
And the reason he thought that Obama will deliver that sort of legislation, he did. And on the grave of Kennedy, his son went and put a flower on his grave and said, "Daddy, it is delivered." So those are very powerful tools. America truly is the most powerful country in the world. There is no country right now compared to America. But Obama made America part of the global world, not the big kid on the block, but part of the global world. And Obama, during his time, during the 8 years time, never started a war anywhere. He tried to eliminate wars that were started before, which has hurt the American image in the world as a bully and all those kind of things. And it really brought America closer to the global community.
Right.
And this is something that nobody can nobody can deny.
Right. Let's leave it at that, and then we go to Dr. Mumo. Okay. When you're talking about he did not really start war, we've heard also from the president-elect that Obama himself started the ISIS. He's the inventor of ISIS, according to president-elect.
Nonsense.
Yes, you say it's nonsense, but we know, of course, he also inherited a lot of gauntlet of challenges. First of all, we know the Iraqi war that was there, and he pulled out the troops from Iraq. But the issue of ISIS also will always dog Obama's legacy as well, because they say the fact that there was no ironclad decision for Americans to actually go and, you know, try and stem this war in Syria has led to what we have today. No. Looking at his copybook, do you think Syria will be blotting Obama's legacy as well?
Well, there are many things I would like to agree with Professor Medamba, you know, on the issue of President Obama, because he's a representation of a visual expression in many ways of a consolidated American democracy.
Yes.
He came in as someone against a lot of odds, you know, a black person, and it shows that institutions make a country. Mm-hmm. And of course, then when it comes to matters of statecraft, he was coming from a very difficult situation because, you know, we had the Bush administration and, you know, the problems of post 9/11 and so on. He tried to manage this. He tried to speak to the Arab-Israeli conflict and many other things. And matters of statecraft, unfortunately, sometimes don't blend in very well with exactly what you may be a very good person, mm-hmm. but you know, state interests and international politics and great power politics can convolute the picture. Mm-hmm. But I think President Obama really tried much to do that. Of course, I know the conspiracy theories to do with ISIS. Mm-hmm. There are scholars who have said, especially out there, that some of them very radical, even in the United States, that ISIS was started to destroy the Arab world and all that. You know, we've had a lot of challenges in the context of, for example, when they went into Tripoli.
Yes.
And, you know, the death of, I think that whole thing of Libya was not well handled. I'm sorry, it was not a good thing. But all in all, there are some things, you see a lot of similarities between President Obama and Mandela, especially the genius of Mandela. Obama did not come with vengeance to say blacks were enslaved, they were killed by white and Arabs and all this. He didn't do that. He tried to unite the people, and even during his final speech, you see how many just white people so happy about Barack Obama. It's a good thing.
It's a good thing.
Yeah.
Let's hear from Dr. Mustafa. You hold with his view. The Libya controversy as well. We have also Professor Noam Edamba saying, yes, he did not really start any wars, right? And I'm still on that particular notion of Donald Trump saying he is the inventor of ISIS. Is he?
Yeah, first of all, Obama is leaving office head high, having accomplished unprecedented results in the history of America. For 75 straight months, the America's economy grew, and month on month added workers onto America's economy. He inherited the economy that was in shambles, that was in recession from Bush. The question of security and wars, Obama simply inherited many wars. He inherited the war in Iraq, in Afghanistan, that was started by the Republicans. The issue about ISIS is something that there are many folks who would like to use that and pile up pressure on the Democrats. The international liberal perspective that has been the hallmark of Obama's leadership demanded that he actually ended those wars. ISIS came in as a result and flourished because of two processes. One, the invasion of Iraq way back in 2003 by the so-called coalition that was led by Bush and Blair. And secondly, the very myopic, I must say even stupid, sectarian thinking by the Arabs themselves about how to manage their own politics, the Shia versus Sunni divide that we see in Iran, in Iraq, and in the Gulf countries. So what Americans have been doing and the Western countries just manipulating these divisions, deep divisions within the Arab world and within the Muslim world. Obama tried his best. Obama has been asking and pleading with the Arabs to resolve these issues and not to look at each other as Shias and Sunnis. And this is one man, as Dr. Mumo Zhao said and Professor Midamba said, now joins the league of people like Mandela, Abraham Lincoln, and the rest, a statement that the world will truly, truly miss.
All right, and we can talk about also the issue, or you mentioned of the issue of also the Iran nuke deal. We know the nuclear deal, that was a very ticklish issue because there was opposition from every quarter. And we saw also the Prime Minister of Israel, Benjamin Netanyahu, going to address the Congress on this regard. And you say, I stand here before you, Congress, as also the Moses of this time, who's trying to help Israel, that this is a bad deal. And President Barack Obama should not go full steam ahead and also negotiate this deal with Iran as well. So the nuke deal also has been, you know, very, very fixated on Obama's legacy, even as he leaves, because people are saying, now how can we give free rein? They cannot be trusted, the Iran's, with the nuclear weapons, you know. So do you think also in that regard, there was a frosty relationship that developed between Israel and America because of the nuke deal that was fostered by Barack Obama?
First, Dibal, I can't trust an Ayatollah with nuclear bombs or nuclear industry. I can't, personally. Then I feel so painful when I hear people refer to President Donald Trump as president-elect. For me, that is very painful because he's not. It is because of the American systems of state colleges. Otherwise, the most popular person during the elections was Hillary, according to the people, the masses.
But we do also, the Electoral College met, I think, was it in January? Yeah, beginning of this year, to actually verify that particular election, of course.
It is because of the Electoral College, but the popular vote went to Clinton. And you could see yesterday, you could see Obama when he went back home to Chicago. It's winter. And you could see a lot of people braving the winter cold to listen to Obama's farewell speech. And Obama said he is going to take a back seat, relax, and perhaps enjoy Trump. But you can't enjoy Trump's presidency because as he enters the State House, White House now, he has already started practicing nepotism.
Okay.
He has already appointed his son as the closest advisor, that 5-6-year-old
son-in-law.
Yes, so you can see, the next time he will bring his wife, his daughters. This is a president of Central Africa Republic, not a global power like the United States.
But we understand. No, we can actually broach that particular issue even right now because there has been a broad consultation in that regard with the federal nepotism law that he cannot actually, as he has been advised, that is the son-in-law, we're talking about Kushner here, that he can actually be the president's advisor because that is the West Wing of the White House, and that is not really affected by the federal statute law on nepotism. Is that so?
Let me not go there first.
All right, can we hold it for now? We'll look at the legacy and then we'll come to what is really happening.
I hear the boy will not, I call him a boy, I hear the boy will not get any salary.
Yeah,
he will just be, but then I was one, he has a lot of companies he was heading. Now he goes to stay with his father in White House without a salary. And this is a guy Trump, who cannot trust CIA, he cannot trust FBI. So what kind of a president are we having?
But he's the most trusted advisor.
To his father?
To Donald Trump.
What is the difference between the old Africa, the old African presidents who used to surround themselves with their relatives? What's the difference? This guy is taking America back, you know, way back. When President Obama is forward-looking and forward-moving, this guy is now taking America backwards.
Just a moment. But we have also history that will bear us down, that is also JF Kennedy has his own brother in the White House during his presidency as well. There was an issue of nepotism, but there was a navigation that actually there was a leeway in law that could happen.
I believe that Bobby Kennedy was the most qualified person.
The Bobby Kennedy was what
Bobby
we're talking
about. Yes. Most qualified person to become the Attorney General.
So
United
you think
States.
Kushner is
so
he's not
you
qualified?
You cannot mix both talk. This young man. No,
so what is the difference? You're talking about
young
man experientially.
When was that?
No, just a moment.
That is
we're talking
years
about
ago, not now.
The young man.
What has changed? The law is still law.
No, the young man has no experience at all in government. Has no demonstrated interest in government in the past.
And so is just a moment. And so is President-elect Donald Trump as well.
Well,
experientially.
Issue is anybody can be elected, but you better have some of the best people working for you. Okay, Kennedy did that, Obama did that. He had people who don't necessarily agree with him, but they're top qualified.
Kushner has actually shown a very refined business acumen in running of his companies that now he's going to actually give the reins of his companies to the family members.
I'm not sure about the jury is still out. Mm-hmm. Jury is still out on this. I mean, this guy on the piece of Henry Kissinger on Washington Post the other day is either going to be one of the strongest president of the United States, is going to be or one of the worst president that United States ever elected, and he will be a one-term. The jury is out. There is so much to be learned about this guy. He's different than anybody has ever been elected in the United States, and you cannot come in. You cannot come in simply because you are wealthy. He's not the wealthiest man in the world, the top five or the top 10 in the world. But he's got the biggest megaphone right now in the world. He can either take America back 100 years, or he can do something that all of us don't know, which is surprisingly. At this point, I don't know. I want to get back to the issue of nuclear, Iran nuclear, for one moment.
Yes.
The most important thing Obama tried to do, number one, is to bring people under the one umbrella. The idea that Iran is a renegade country and treated as not equal and everything, and then Iran is producing nuclear. Mm-hmm. Now, the point is Obama wanted engagement instead of war. And so he brought Iran at a very crucial time in times of history. Mm-hmm. But he also is the first president of the United States that has quadrupled the support for the state of Israel. So the contention between Netanyahu and Obama is that he did not support the idea of having them go and eliminate Iranian nuclear weapon. That's not the way to go. But now you also remember that it is Barack Obama who went and apologized in Japan for what happened in the Second World War. And it's Obama who is going to Cuba, and it's Obama who is going to Vietnam to apologize and mend fences where damage has been made. These are the legacy that will resonate for years in the eye of the world.
So you agree with Professor Naomi Damba that we can credit Barack Obama with a modest record of foreign policy successes, especially when
not modest, not modest.
You think it's very robust?
They're robust, robust. Okay, in a way.
Okay, yes, we look at the mending of fences and the frosty relationship that was there between America and Cuba. He's done that. Yeah. He's also gone to Japan. We know about the Hiroshima with this little boy bomb that was dropped there many years back, I think in 1945.
Yes.
And then we also had the issue of The issue of also we had the Japan Prime Minister going to, we saw it just in December, but also to pay homage to, you know, the fallen soldiers who also were affected by the Hiroshima war and the bombings as well. But looking at that, the Iran nuclear deal, reconciliation with Cuba, and also climate change. He's been an avatar, actually, when we talk about climate change, and we can say also the poster boy child of climate, fostering for climate change, which Barack Obama, not really Barack Obama, but the president-elect, that is Donald Trump, has said also with the France climate change policies, he's not going to agree with much of that climate change policies that are actually in France as well. But this really flies in the face of what Barack Obama has done when it comes also to issues of climate change as well.
Yeah, let me say this. I think in many ways, President-elect Trump may not be very popular.
One. Don't say President-elect, say President.
President, that's right.
No, let me say it to be installed.
No, don't say President-elect, say President of
This is
Trump.
President Donald Trump, and it is okay.
As it stands, Barack Obama, until the 20th of January, he's the president of us. He hands over the instruments of power to...
Indeed, I wanted to stay within that purview, so okay then. So
he seems to be ruffled by this.
we have Donald Trump here, and he's not popular very much in many places. But sometimes you find that systems don't change radically. And even if as an individual you want to do extraordinary things, when you have very strong institutions like those in the US, they tend to change or permeate your direction. In a certain, you know, to a certain degree. So it's not easy for us just to say that he is totally unpredictable, because the institutions, you know, an institution is something that has, when you say something institutionalized, it has stable patterns of behavior, and you can predict what will happen. So I would not really disagree with Professor Midamba, but I want sort of to bring in the idea that he is not going to be, you know, that kind of renegade who you can't hold,
yes.
because of the institutions. That is very important. He's really in his campaign, and many things that he said, some of them he's already reneged on them, because it's impossible to go that way. But there is something that Trump really tried to appeal to the American people, and I think that's how he got a lot of votes, that our culture, our culture, who we are as the American people, and we, you know, that kind of our Americanness, you know, that kind of thing. He really appealed that someone wants to destroy our culture, our freedom from out there. And so we are in danger. And he really tapped on that, and they believed him. How true that was then will show, unless it was just a campaign gimmick. But because he will need to work with the rest of the world. Because when you're number one, you need to stay number one is not easy. Yes. So you need to think about other people. And there's what we call power transitions. So President Obama, they really tried to manage and bring in Iran so that they know what is going on there. And I think that is what they were trying to do, instead of just declaring total war and doing all that. I don't think Iran has any kind of, if what you would call a powerful nuclear machine, but they have the power in terms of generating, if it is used well, it can propel Iran to very good industrial growth and so on.
Right.
But of course, everyone is worried, of course, about misuse of nuclear power.
Misuse of nuclear power. But we can also talk about misuse of chemical weapon, because we know in August 2012, we had the issue of the red line. And that was a very critical juncture in the conflict where we can see Syria was threatening to use chemical weapons. And we had Barack Obama saying that if they go further and use chemical weapon, that he's going to take military action, right? And he was asking also President Assad to step down. But when chemical weapons were used by Assad exactly a year later, we had 1,500 people really dying. And there was no military action that was promised by Barack Obama. He backed off. And we see instead Russia took up that initiative to get Assad to willingly disarm his chemical weapons stocks. This has been also a very contentious issue right now that is happening, because we had a vacuum in Syria where the Americans had promised we'll take a military action, and they did not do that. Now that Russia went and actually took that particular position, and it seems like he's supporting Assad right now and the Assad regime, there has been also a foster relationship between Russia and America and Russia and the rest of the world in that regard. We have human rights violations that we can see that is happening. A case in point is what is happening in Aleppo. And we can look also keenly into that, where also the UN had failed dismally to make sure that human rights violations are not violated in Aleppo as well. So the inaction and not making good of your promise that President Barack Obama did actually make in regard to Syria, do you think is what led to where we are right now? We'll come to you. Let's just hear from Dr. Mustafa, then we come to you, Professor Nomi Dam.
Yeah, one way or the other. And this this started way back, you know, with the United Nations Resolution 1973 that was aimed at stopping Gaddafi from massacring people in Benghazi.
Yes.
And unfortunately, the U.S., you know, stretched that resolution to move on to regime change. And Assad learnt about that. The Russians saw that. China saw that. And they say that was never going to happen again. The question of the chemical weapons that were used in Syria, yeah, that was a false flag. The first use of the chemical weapons that killed more than 1,500 people, as we have said, it was not the Assad regime that actually used the chemical weapons. It was a false flag. It was manipulated. It was actually, I understand, the Saudis who actually engineered that, the use of the chemical weapons, so that America could attack. Remember, militaries have used false flags before. Israel has used false flags.
So it was a booby trap, so to speak, to
actually down a United States, a carrier, so that and blame that on the Palestinians. Now, that was a false flag. But as the war became convoluted, Russians went in, we started seeing the Free Syrian Army using chemical weapons, we started seeing the terrorist groups getting their hands onto the chemical weapons, and Assad regime started using those or putting chlorine into those barrel bombs and dropping those on Aleppo. The whole thing became so messy, and that's why Kerry has said that war in Syria is not going to be won by anybody. It has to be a negotiated solution. That has to be, all parties have got to be on the table. And it's a very sad situation, what we have seen in Syria, a case of many lost opportunities.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But do you think also the United Nations has failed dismally, especially in the human rights violation in Aleppo?
Because precisely. And United Nations is as strong as the nations that constitute the United Nations itself. If Russia is taking one side, if America is taking one side, China the other side, Britain, France, permanent members of the United Nations, these are people who hold veto powers, then the United Nations is going to be terribly, terribly weakened. And if you look at today, the people who are holding brief as heads of states or president, we have in the United States of America president-elect Donald Trump. You know, from the far right, yes, we have Theresa May, conservative. We have China, Jinping, you know, again, very conservative. Who's the other permanent French? God forbid if Marie Le Pen comes in. Then we have a situation where the five permanent members of the United Nations are all from the far-right conservative camps. Then the world becomes another situation.
Yes, within the Security Council, the big five.
That's right.
All right, let's hear from Dr. Apollos Mashira in that regard.
You know, that's Peter from South Sudan. Karibu Kenya. Yes. You know, for the first time, I liked Russia when Russia intervened in Syria. Because, you know, Aleppo was a caliphate. by the ISIS. And you know, Aleppo city had 2.5 million people.
Yes.
And it was not under the control of the government of Syria. Mm-hmm. That, for me, was a good thing for Russia to intervene.
Yes.
And because these are power relations, you also saw when US and NATO saw that Russia is already in Syria, mm-hmm. they went to Iraq mm-hmm. to save Mosul. You know, Mosul is also a very big area
yes.
with millions of people. So they also went to save. For me, I see power relations. Mm-hmm. And during these power relations, you know, China tries to see where China is like a watermelon. It wants to see where they can get money without getting so much involved because they need a lot of money for their population. Mm-hmm. So you see, these are power relations between the US and Russia. Now I am wondering what will happen because you can see Trump is already together with Putin. Mm-hmm. Now perhaps when they combine forces, we do not know where we are going. That's why I'm worried about the future. Because you never trust Putin, neither can you trust Trump. So I don't know what will happen to the rest of the world. You know, the Chinese, the British, the French, Kenya, you know, all of us. So these are power relations, and I think when they combine, ISIS will go.
All right, let's also hear from Peter Biarajak. I think, good to see you. Thank you for coming in, though it came a bit late. I think traffic also has really affected you this morning. But we are actually looking at what is happening right now. Of course, the big day for Barack Obama. This was his final speech. He was addressing, of course, the nation from Chicago, his native town. And we wanted also to hear from you, especially in regards to South Sudan and Obama's legacy. Do you think he has been a pivotal figure in trying to make sure that peace is secured in South Sudan?
Well, thank you, Diwal, and once again, my apologies. As you mentioned, traffic in Kenya is crazy, and then driving also with your countrymen is quite challenging. But, you know, with Obama, it's sort of like a mixed feeling for us.
Yes.
Because when Obama came to power, we had a lot of hopes in him, not just only in South Sudan, but in many parts of Africa. Mm-hmm. And of course, South Sudan got independence under Obama's watch. But many South Sudanese are disappointed with what Obama administration was able to achieve. I think early on, his relationship with President Kiir did not kick out very well. And as a result, South Sudan did not continue to have close relationship that we had with the U.S. during George W. Bush administration.
Okay.
But at the same time, for the first time, I think, in the U.S. government history, mm-hmm. you had Secretary of State, Ambassador to the United Nations, you had the National Security Advisor, all of whom had been to South Sudan and deeply care about South Sudan. Mm-hmm. During our independence, John Kerry was there. And now Obama is leaving. And I don't think Trump actually mentioned word Africa during the entire mm-hmm. campaign, unless if he was insulting somebody. So it's quite worrisome for us because now we are going to have a new team that does not have South Sudan as a priority, does not have Africa as a priority. And we are quite concerned, especially with the way things are deteriorating in South Sudan. Mm-hmm. So it's a mixed feeling for us. We had a lot of hopes. We didn't achieve much. But we had very close relationship and people that have deep understanding of South Sudan. Mm-hmm. It's not going to be the same with Michael Flint, with Rex Tillerson, and with Nikki Haley at the United Nations.
Mm-hmm. All right, we will be slicing and dicing more of this when we come back. We want to take a short break right now. And of course, you're watching Standing on Guard and Holy Code this morning with Professor Noam Idamba, who is the Vice Chancellor of KCA University and also an expert on foreign policy and defense. Also, we have with us Dr. Mumo, who is a governance and security expert. We have also with us Dr. Mustafa Yusuf Ali, who is a conflict resolution and national security expert. Also, Dr. Apollos Mashira is a criminologist from Egerton University, and Peter Biarajak is the director of International Growth Center in South Sudan. So we take a short break right now. When you come back, of course, we also take a panoramic view of what is happening in the world as well, and we shall also be finishing up looking at the tail ends of our discussion on the farewell speech of Barack Obama, his legacy, right, his triumphs, and as also we are looking also at his disappointments in the 8-year tenure that he's had as a president of United States. We're looking at Obama's legacy as well. Russia has been also a thorn in the flesh, so to speak, in Obama's legacy. We've seen that frosty relationships. They cannot see eye to eye when they meet. And we know there has been also so much controversy with the election of Donald Trump, where it is alleged that also Russians really played a large part of it. And we can see now, of course, this deployment of armament within you know, those territories of Russia, where they're trying to bolster up also their weaponry and also foster a stronger NATO as well. I'm holding court this morning with Professor Naomi Damba, who is the Vice Chancellor of KC University, also is an expert on defense and foreign policy. Also, we have with us Dr. Mumo, who is governance and security strategist and expert. Also, we have also Dr. Mustafa Yusuf Ali, who is a conflict resolution and a national security expert. Also, we have with us Dr. Apollos Mashera, who is a criminologist from Egerton University. Peter Biara Ejak is the director of International Growth Center from South Sudan, Juba. Gentlemen, we continue with the discussion. I think we left it at you, but also we wanted to hear from Professor Naomi Damba. You've seen the trucks, you've seen the weaponry that is going to NATO's to bolster, because they fear Russians' aggression. And I know also you've been heavily involved in and brokering you know, peace talks when it comes to Ukraine and Crimea as well. We shall come to you, Peter Birojak. But looking at his legacy, Russia, thorn in the flesh, as I've mentioned, and we were discussing a raft of issues as well. I don't know, you actually wanted, it was on your tongue to say something before you took a short break.
Well, I wanted to get back on, I think Mustafa made a very nice analysis of the chemical use in Syria. And the idea that Obama did not do anything is not true. Obama stated a very clear red line for the Syrian government.
He did not. He promised the military action, which he didn't do, isn't
it? It's, you don't have to use military action. What he did was put the fleet in the Mediterranean.
Yes.
And order complete inspection of any chemical stockpile verified under the UN, and it was indeed, it was done. Obama was hesitant to do the kind of thing, the kind of bombing that Russia is doing in Syria, because what you end up doing is having millions of collateral damage. And and in his 8 years of presidency, that's a very powerful legacy that he's leaving behind. So he did actually act, you know, without dropping the bomb.
Without dropping the bomb.
Yes.
So there was no the vacuum there. Let's hear from Peter Biara Jack. I think you have a different opinion.
Well, first of all, on the Syrian situation, I think Obama made a huge mistake in announcing the red line. And then when the push came to shove, he didn't actually stay true to the red line that he put in place. And, you know, in diplomacy, these kind of signals, when what you say and what you do matters, and when America make a commitment that this is a red line, and it happens, and then nothing happens, it weakens the confidence in the United States of America. This July, Dubai, I was in Poland at the NATO summit. This year was a very peculiar NATO summit. Last year, 2016. Yes. And there were a number of decisions that were made at this summit. Number one, the NATO made a decision to deploy four brigades around countries that are members of NATO who are in Eastern Europe and who feel threatened by the presence of Russia, what is seen as a resurgent Russia. So one brigade is going to be hosted in Bulgaria, one will be in Estonia, one will be in Poland, and the other one will be in Latvia. And all these four brigades, they are very well equipped with all sort of weaponry to engage in all five domains of warfare: land, air, sea, space, and cyber. And it's part of a comprehensive strategy that the NATO is putting in place to contain Russia. There's a lot of worry about what Russia is doing. Putin is very good at these tactical games, and he managed to outmaneuver Obama for quite some time, especially with the situation of Syria and the situation in Ukraine. And there's a lot of worry now in Eastern Europe about what Putin's intentions are, what Putin's ideas are. So I think it's fair to say, in regard to the U.S.-Russian relationship, that the sort of containment that we saw during the Cold War is coming back. And you see all different pieces of strategy being put in place. And I think it's one of the reasons why Russia intervened very seriously in the U.S. elections and tried to have an ally in the White House in the name of Donald Trump, so that this strategy that NATO is putting in place with the U.S. leadership is reduced, and Russia is able to have a space in which it can maneuver. Of course, Russian objective, and I think the Russian, if you read like Russian foreign policy newspapers, has made this very clear. Russia fundamentally believes that the global order that has existed, especially since the collapse of Soviet Union,
yes,
is anti-Russia. Mm-hmm. And the Russian strategic objective is to dismantle this world order that has been constructed, mm-hmm. and to create a different order that is more conducive to the interests of Russia. So I think it would be interesting to see what Trump will actually do. Personally, I don't think that there's a lot that Trump can do to change what we see as different pieces of strategy being put place by the alliance. Mm-hmm.
All right. So we have any sentimental from your end, Dr. Mumo?
I believe that when you have a global hegemonic power like the United States, I think the question of leadership, global leadership, cannot escape them. They always have got to be there. And sometimes I'm seeing a situation where everything also that Russia does is painted bad. It doesn't mean they are not other. I remember Dr. Mashira himself saying, you know, there was Mosul and what do you call that other place where there was a battle in Iraq. Mm-hmm. And similar things happened there. But when it is Russia doing something, they say it's all bad. Look at the mess in Libya. You know, total mess. I've never seen a country messed up like that. Mm-hmm. So you need to read in between the lines, because it is true that countries may be worried that others want to rise and get up to them and reach their level and so on. That's a standard thing about international politics. But at the same time, you don't need to get carried away by what everyone says about anyone else, mm-hmm. because countries get into relations with others to meet their own selfish interests. And that must always be the standard. That is what the realists tell us. So we need to be careful about how we interpret it, because they may say that Russia is the problem, and that is not exactly it. So
right.
I think
Mustafa,
time will tell as we move on with it.
Yeah, I can see
the Dibal, is these power games by United States of America and now Russia, which is flexing its muscle, is not going to be a good thing for the world.
Yes,
Russia has its own interest in Ukraine. It might use Syria as a bargaining chip for whatever it wants in its immediate frontiers in Eastern Europe. And as Peter said, you know, mobilizing that kind of weaponry onto the north of Russia in all five domains of warfare is really going to undermine the peace efforts that we should all be working for, and the United Nations should be working on. We're going to see situations happening in the Middle East because of exactly some of the decisions that NATO has had to put up. And Russia is not stupid. They've seen how the United States has used raw power and military means to amass more power and to build on its military-industrial complex. And Russia is going to do the same and is going to create situations where it can also enable or sell its weaponry to the third world countries. And Africa suffered, Asia suffered, when that kind of rivalry took place. It's up to the less developed countries to see where they want to go, how they want to do or relate to US, Russia, and the others. But unfortunately, it's not going to be pleasant. And in the coming years, I think we will see many more regions being lit up because of this, or corrupted, becoming more warlike because of the kind of a relationship that we are seeing between Russia and the United States of America.
All right, we need to be winding up on this. Then we look also to other issues and we come locally, what is happening also security-wise in the country as well. Let's hear from Dr. Apollo.
If you think about Russia and you see Putin, Putin is very, very desperate to have his socialist republics, the ones that left the USSR. He's so desperate. He wants the Soviets to come back so that he can be as powerful as the US. In fact, the moment you go to the Kremlin, you can see all those countries that left Russia are still there. They are still burning. And there is an office that has all the documentation about those lost countries. So the man is desperate, and that's why he is now going to Istanbul. He is going everywhere because these are power relations. He wants to be equal to the US. And that's why the other day when Obama mentioned something about the hacking, Putin said he's not going to comment. He'll wait until 20th of January when Donald comes to power. He'll now comment because he will see now the relations coming together. So I think Putin just wants to expand.
All right. Let's be winding up on it, of course, and we look also at the dream team of Obama, which also has drawn a lot of flack. We have Sessions, who also was before Senate, you know, for Senator Grilling yesterday. And we saw also the KKK coming to protest outside the Congress. Was it Congress? Yes, because he's a controversial figure when it comes to racism as well. But as we're winding up, a very ticklish issue also that also is being left on Obama's legacy. We have the bathroom debate that is ongoing right now. It has not been conclusive and is actually handing over power the 20th, right? Did Obama keep his promise? Because earlier we saw from his stump speeches when he was really, you know, getting for the election, he promised, of course, he avoided the issue of gay rights issues. But now, during his tenure, and especially at during the tail end of his tenure, he changed tone. And of course, we have the bathroom debate right now with the gay rights movement, the gay pride also given, you know, he says we support gay rights movements. This particular shift, when you talk about diplomacy, where you have a change of tone midway, how does it really affect, you know, the credibility of a leader as well?
I think, Dubar, there has been a fundamental shift in these sort of social cultural debates during the time of Obama. Not necessarily for what Obama did, but because of the ruling of the Supreme Court. And because of that, for the first time now, the kind of discretion that used to exist with a different president on how to approach this issue of gay rights is now sort of fixed. I think if you watch Jeff Sessions' testimony yesterday, he was asked specifically about this and what he will do. And although he has come out in the past being very strong anti-gay rights and so forth, he had to say that he will implement the law as it is, because now it is the law of the land. Gay marriage is the law of the land. It's legal in all over the United States because of the Supreme Court ruling. So Donald Trump may have some discretion in terms of foreign policy, especially with what has been happening with Obama, with different U.S. organizations trying to make aid conditioned in how countries respond to the gay rights. I think that part is going to reduce a bit. It's not going to be as strong as it would be under Donald Trump, especially under Republican administration, Republican-controlled Congress. But at the same time, until the Supreme Court reverse that decision within the United States, some of these things under Obama are going to happen. Then the other thing I want to mention is U.S. government is enormous, right? It's like huge. And it takes a while before somebody even get a sense of how it works, especially someone like Donald Trump, who has never worked in a government, is going to have a very difficult time in truly understanding how this government works. And especially is already having a very rocky relationship with the intelligence agencies and intelligence agencies in America are extremely, extremely, extremely important. So normally it takes like a year or two before you get a better understanding and before you decide which direction you're going to take the country and be able to actually move it in that direction. I think a lot of the promises Obama made, of course, did not come to pass because of the difficult way in which the U.S. government worked. And that was designed by purpose. U.S. government and the U.S. Constitution was designed in such a way that nothing will ever work. And when you try to do transformational change, you find a lot of different roadblocks that blocks you in fundamental way. I think Donald Trump is going to see the same thing. I think it might actually be worse in the case of Donald Trump. Already he's talking about the wall, which was supposed to be paid by Mexico. Now he's asking Congress to pay for the wall, and he has been promising that Mexico was going to pay for the wall. Now he's asking Congress to pay for the wall. So a lot of these promises that he made during the campaign trail, where he would just say, trust me, now we're going to see something very different, and it's naturally the way it is.
All right. Yes, we need to be winding up on this. We read a story also of, of Jerusalem truck attack. I think this happened during the weekend. It's an old story, but we highlighted this morning because we need to talk about also the relationship of America and Israel right now. Yeah. You have been to Israel, I think, last year. Many times. Yeah, many times. And you spoke very glowingly about Israel and the way, you know, they are watertight when it comes to security and also watching over their servicemen, the military men as well. We had this, and we can see an emergence of another sort of an attack where trucks... they have to be feared nowadays. When you see a lorry written the White Lord on, you have to take caution. Yeah. Right? You never know who is behind that wheel. Yeah. So in terms of Israel and America as well, we are winding up. We have Donald Trump who's coming, and also we can see Benjamin Netanyahu who is warming up towards also Donald Trump as well. Will we see a mending of relations? Resetting of relations between America and Israel, very briefly.
There is no there is no rift between the state of Israel and America.
You don't think so?
There is no.
With the nuclear deal? You don't think there was a nuclear deal?
I mean, that is Netanyahu. But when you talk to the majority of the Israelis, like I have done, most Israelis are tired of this war.
Yes.
They are for a two-state solution. Which was the answer, and a number of Israelis, former leaders, all died with the idea of a two-state solution. You cannot continue to have that strip of millions of people who have no hope in the world and expect peace in the future. And so the issue between what Trump is saying what Trump is saying right now, Netanyahu, is not going to work. Until they find out that we must have a state called Palestine and a state called Israel in order for us to have a solution in the Middle East.
All right, so,
and that's a wake-up call. For
so we have another regime, Israel and Palestine is still a ticklish issue, especially with the rehabilitation right now really happening. No one has been able to. It seems all the regimes, this will be a holy grail.
Now, Deborah, let me talk about the truck. Situation as a really an imminent threat elsewhere in the world. You know, these guys, the ISIS and the rest, are 10 miles ahead of us. As you were thinking about this, they're thinking about the next strategy. We've seen truck in France, we've seen truck in Germany, and now we see truck in Israel. Where else next? And where is the most vulnerable place? What about these trucks that are coming from Mombasa all the way to Uganda border? Are they all transporting goods and services? So we have to rethink
our strategy as well.
We have to rethink our security strategy.
All right, thank you. Let's hear from Mumo as we're winding up on this very briefly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think we have a phenomenon here that has to do with. The rapporteurs of terrorism, and we have what you have the lone wolf and the what we call the moribund knit tight cell of a few, and that is the the issue with Charlie Hebdo, Paris, Nice, Ansbach, down in Bavaria, what you have in all the way up to what we had the other day in Jerusalem. So these are situations, and we have had a situation here in Kapenguria the other day when we had Abdul Hakim Maslah.
Yes.
And all that. So the repertoires are changing, but it's a signal that the hard military strategic approach must be well balanced with the soft human security based CVE, what we call countering violent extremism process. And we are working on this a lot. We are advising, we are training very closely on these matters as we are talking. And I'm seeing a lot of improvement in the Kenyan context.
Thank you.
And I know that these rapporteurs are there, but the most important thing is to attack not just the terrorist, but the ideology, the terrorism.
Thank you.
And that is what we are working on.
Thank you. We need to also take this conversation deeper and look at what has happened also in Gambia right now. Changing tone, you guys were laughing at the way others believe that Jammeh has mystical power. And I think this also was was also a bone of contention that we were having with Dr. Bashira as well, when he was telling me that he's a witch doctor, and I startly deny. So I tend to believe that he is a witch doctor.
He is
a witch doctor. Yeah, so the change of tone, we've seen also African leaders led by Nigeria, Sierra Leone also, and Liberia as well, amongst others. They're now in Gambia to try and persuade President Jammeh to step down. We've seen also there has been a judgment of this particular constitutional issue right now in court. And this was adjourned because the some of the judges never showed up. So the mentality of African leaders not really conceding power, what really became of Jammeh that now at one point you're conceding defeat, giving a very moving speech of defeat, and we can see at last this is one of the epitome of democracies that we talk about in Africa. Then it changes tone.
This guy said he's going to rule for a billion years.
He's going to rule for a billion years.
A billion years. He is saying that Gambia,
by he's immortal.
Gambia is starved of Supreme Court judges. Because the judges who excel in Gambia go away, like Bensouda. Tell me, which judge will come from Ghana or Nigeria or Cote d'Ivoire to go to Gambia and preside? He'll be killed. So they are fearing. So the guy, since the court will never take place, the guy is going to be in power until judges go. But now tell me, which judge will agree to go? I told you that this guy is a witch doctor. He is a conqueror of two rivers. Remember, he has, I don't know whether I can remind you his names. His Excellency Sheikh Professor Alhaji Dr. Yahya Abdul Aziz Amal Jema Junkun Jamal Nasir Din Babil Mansa. The guy is a witch doctor. Now the judges cannot go to Banjul. Which judge will go to preside? They will be killed by this man. So you can see now he has actually gone loud to stay in power. He tells any judge who will come here, he will not leave Banjul alive. So judges are intelligent people. So the man will continue to rule like he said.
All right. So him and Mugabe, we had also Grace saying Mugabe is going to rule for even beyond the grave.
Yes.
We have a lot of surprises. The other day, my boss, the vice chancellor, was glorifying Israel. We were saying that they are far ahead. Like now, see, ISIS had entered Jerusalem and they have killed people. I thought people are killed in Nairobi and Kampala, not in Tel Aviv. But you can see ISIS now is way ahead of everybody.
All right.
Well, the unfortunate thing with terror is that terrorists can strike anywhere. And this is why it's very important to deal with the ideology and those push factors, the pull factors that are actually the major cause of terrorism. It's no respecter of military might. It's asymmetric in all its sense. With regard to Yahya Jammeh, this guy is just confused. He's drunk with power. In fact, very drunk with power. And what ECOWAS is now doing, led by Buhari, is the right thing to do. They have to get this guy out. And he's lost elections. And he's now very erratic. He's going to make West Africa, or rather Senegal, Gambia, that area to be very, very volatile if he is not, if there's no intervention to make sure that Barrow actually takes up the presidency.
All right, let's hear from Peter as we're winding up on that.
Well, two things on the issue of terrorism in Israel. I think it's a very interesting in America, you have this Trump phenomena. And if you look at the Trump voters and Trump movement, a lot of them are anti-Semitic. These are people that do not like Jews, but in a weird, funny way, you find them believing that they have to support Israel because of their own understanding of Bible and the return of Jesus. But I think what Netanyahu is doing, and I've seen this in Europe, by the way, in Europe, you are having governments that are getting fed up with Israel. Clearly, everywhere in Europe, people are getting fed up with Israel. They say Israel is not doing what they need to do to actually resolve the problem, and which is true. But if you try to imagine where this problem will come over time with this expansion of settlements, is de facto going to lead into one state solution. And if you have seen the perspective of the Palestinian over the last few 2 to 3 years, it has changed from adamant desire for two-state solution to realization that maybe one-state solution may be in their interest. And this, I think, is where Netanyahu is not really paying attention, because in the end, Israel would have to choose. Either it will become an apartheid state that is run by minority Jews that oppress the majority Palestinians, or they really have to stop these settlements and allow the Palestinians to have their own state. Either way, if they don't do this, and honestly, in another 5 years, if this thing continues the way it is going with this sort of settlements, and U.S. Congress, by the way, being controlled by Israeli lobbyists, what will happen is you will have a de facto one state. And I think Israel is going to be pressured by everybody in the world, including some of its strongest allies, including America, to allow one vote for one person, and automatically Jews are going to become a minority in the so-called Jewish state. So I think this is a real concern that these people need to do, to pay attention to. On the issue of Yahya Jammeh, this man, of course, is just crazy. In my view, I've never seen, it's like, it has like two split personalities. And you don't know how he's going to wake up in the morning and what he will decide. But I really hope ECOWAS forge ahead and get this man out of power, because the precedent is setting is extremely dangerous, not only for the region in West Africa, but everywhere in the continent. You can concede an election, then change your mind and want to use a military. And it also shows the lack of professionalism in the armed forces, because things really happen when security sector leaders do the right thing. And in Gambia, they have failed to do the right thing. And now the country is going to pay for it. Definitely there's going to be a war, and ECOWAS is going to come in and kick this man out.